Harper Audio presents The Destroyers, a novel by Christopher Bollen, performed by Graham Halstead. Time is a game played beautifully by children. Heraclitus. None of the dead come back, but some stay. Unknown, often attributed to St. John the Divine. Prologue. She was starting to enjoy it, the strange, delirious feeling of nothing bad happening. On the last day, Elise stabbed her key into the neck of the motorbike, clipped the helmet strap under her chin, and revved the throttle. She took off toward the port town of Scala. She was a gunshot, a bullet racing, and in the past 10 days she had learned to bank the bends in the roads with the slightest readjustment of her hips. The engine kicked into gear, and she clenched her front teeth as if she held a knife between them. Dead time, all the time. Days fine and rolling and shiftless. She didn't want to think about the end. She had woken at 6 to watch the sun slip out of the Aegean. The Greek island of Patmos was a wheeze of color. Bleach blonde dust, scrub brush of wiry green, the wet metal shine of water, and low rock walls blooming sinus pinks. As Elise ascended a hill, she saw the monastery rise from the cliffs like a cruise ship moored on a mountaintop. Human bodies were scattered along the beaches, silver and limp in the sticky heat. She wanted to be one of them, for another week or maybe forever, lingering between states of hangover and hunger. The beaches here were perfect, and the sea like glass. At night on the island, red lights trailed across the water as tenders returned to their boats. Elise had watched those lights, drunk and loveless and chewing on her split ends, her burnt legs splayed over the hotel balcony. Now the motor was her anthem, and wind squalled along the curves of her shoulders. Other bikers passed her. Young, shirtless Italians with skin the color of dried honey. Italian men always looked 19 to her until they looked 40. Their necks were scarved with beach towels, their waists belted by the arms of their girlfriends who sat side saddle behind them, black hair streaming in the blue. Maybe on this last ride, she shouldn't have bothered with the helmet, the moony, red safety precaution that announced, "I consider speed a threat. I am prone to head injuries. I am an American on vacation." Her vacation was nearly over. The ferry that would take her to Athens was already crossing the sea. The overnight plane that would spit her back into New York must be refueling now in Abu Dhabi or Topeka. On the last day, the world came back, crowded and climate-controlled and filled with New York emergencies, with the same sun uglier and bouncing like her neighbor's basketball through the hallways of her Brooklyn apartment building. For nearly 2 weeks, the hot calm of Patmos had worked as a communication scrambler, blocking all news of shooting rampages and celebrity deaths and Twitter mock outrages that temporarily revived its slack-faced users like personal defibrillation devices. Wars could be breaking out in Canada for all she knew or cared. Instead, Elise had become a specialist in the quiet art of the human form. Right now, she zoomed by 3 lovely, barely covered specimens tripping down a path to the beach. Europeans seemed so indifferent to their bodies, so resigned to and at peace with them. For her, the difference had become increasingly obvious. Europeans had a lifestyle. Americans had their lives. Elise checked her watch. Her vacation wasn't entirely over. She still had time for one quick swim, topless, splashing out alone in her cutoffs. Except Reina was waiting for her at a cafe by the port. Reina had gone ahead with their luggage by taxi so Elise could return the bike to the rental office. Screw Reina, she thought as she glided toward the igloo white houses of Scala. But someone had already screwed Reina on days 4, 5, and 7 of their vacation. Reina, unlike Elise, didn't understand the fundamental law of vacation hookups. No obligation, no regret. Sex so unconfused it wasn't even complicated by a shared language most of the time. It was like getting searched at customs with nothing to declare. Raina had spent the last days of their trip sighing audibly and checking her phone, blaming lack of interest on bad reception.
I'm going to stay by the pool today where I get service. I'm going to climb up to the road again to check my messages.
Elise had wanted to slap her in the face, slap her and talk her into her bikini and snorkel alongside her over the splotchy reefs by Petra Beach. Fried halloumi cheese and white wine at 3, followed by a nap of warm, mingling breaths. Mostly, Elise had gone by herself to the closest beach, where she read and reread the section on Patmos in her guidebook. The rocky, barren island of St. John the Divine, who, exiled by a Roman emperor, wrote the Book of Revelation here in AD 95. Elise hadn't personally witnessed any evidence of the four horsemen, but she loved basking in the sun at the end of the world. She found the apocalypse fit her recent mood. She just hadn't expected to feel so alone upon reaching it. Careening down the steep hillside, she reminded herself that the whole point of the vacation was not to make memories, but to lose track of them. Elise had gotten married at age 24 over a 4th of July weekend. After the divorce 2 months ago, the irony of a wedding on Independence Day became her fallback joke that everyone saw coming as soon as she brought the matter up. Elise had told that joke while standing on the yacht of Raina's new obsession on the afternoon they had met him, their tables touching at a small taverna by a quiet swimming cove. He had invited them back to his boat, and, dripping from the 5-minute swim, they climbed the rungs of the ladder and were wrapped in soft, black towels by the boat's captain. Raina hadn't laughed at the joke, and neither had her new friend. He pulled a t-shirt over his pretty decent body and made drinks while two flags snapped behind him on the stern. One Greek, one Turkish. "Which are you?" Elise had asked. She was the considerate guest, the one who asks strangers about their homelands. "Neither," he said, glancing over at her with such a forced smile she almost apologized for asking. "I was born in Cyprus, but I was raised in the States." He said the States as if it were an untreatable glandular disease instead of a country. An hour later, he and Raina had disappeared below deck. The captain jumped overboard with a spear gun, and Elise had been left to stare at the undulating mounds of the island. She sat on creamy leather cushions, her face and legs browning to red, and the beginning of a heat rash blistering against the strap of her swimsuit. A tooth-like diamond wedged between the cushions shot brilliant glitters of white. She had plucked the ring from the cushions as if the yacht itself were proposing to her. Elise briefly shut her eyes at the memory, even as traffic began to thicken in the port town. The dock was lined with private vessels and fat metal skiffs advertising day trips to nearby islands. Old, gluey men scrubbed on hands and knees. Tweak, tweak, tweak went the wax on wood. Why had she done it? She had threaded the ring on her finger just to see how it looked. Then she spun it around unthinkingly and made a fist so that the diamond was buried in the flesh of her palm. After Raina reemerged on deck wearing her obsession's damp t-shirt, Elise had swum single-fisted back to shore. Now the ring hung on a gold chain around her neck, purposely hidden under her linen shirt. Elise had assumed she could return the ring on her next visit, although there had been no next visit. Not for her. Maybe she had stolen it because Raina had gone below deck without her, or because the diamond couldn't matter much if it had already been lost to the boat cushions, or because she had poured two vodkas while waiting for her friend, and those drinks had made her thirsty for her own impulsive acts. Wanting too much had always been the lonely consequence of alcohol. It was as if with each sip she could feel her bones growing and straining inside of her to take whatever was loose in the world. After Raina's two subsequent sexathons on days 5 and 7, Elise had watched her friend change in their hotel room, her own stomach queasy, fearing allegations. Raina tugged off her bikini top, her breasts, two fried eggs, runny with grease. Her nipples were blistered as if the island's mosquitoes had gotten to them.
"He's a little rough," Raina said, squinting down in assessment. "But also gentle,"
and reported nothing further. He couldn't possibly have noticed the ring's disappearance. He had so much money,
leather-padded, life-jacketed, an open safe bobbing in the sea. Even the gray cat lounging on the boat's control panel had winked at her apathetically. The theft had been a moment of recklessness, a mark of time in the nearly 2 weeks broken only by water and sleep. And nothing had happened, no news or confrontations, only Raina and her slow heartbreak playing like a radio with a faulty dial. Now, Elise applied the brakes. Pale tourists darted across the road like startled first-world chickens. Maybe she'd wear the ring in New York. It was triple the size of the one Dodie had given her with his earnings as a session drummer for past prime bands, trying to unwreck their careers between overdoses. The hiss of cicadas was lost to the sounds of car horns and foreign voices. High season had arrived in Scala. She and Raina were getting out before the beaches were quilted with tourists. A little girl in a straw hat wobbled out in front of her bike, her face as fat and purple as a thumbprint. "Molto carina," Elise called, smiling first happily and then annoyed. On her last day, she was still trying to speak Greek in the only foreign language that she knew. She sped on. Dazed vacationers thronged the taxi stand. Elise passed nuns in faded postcard stalls and satirical doomsday t-shirt shops. The locals had cleverly made a cottage industry out of Armageddon-themed tourist tchotchkes. A group of long-haired hippies stood in front of the vacant police station, holding Bibles and rolled sleeping bags. The island's few administrative buildings were graffitied with the same black, anti-Eurozone messages that had decorated all of Athens, as if for a national holiday of death threats and decline. Ochi, Yavanaitha, kill the West. A bald officer in a sky-blue uniform followed her with his eyes. She parked in front of the bike shop, collected her backpack from the seat compartment, and paid for the rental with the last of her euros. The sun was blasting at 11:02 a.m., and her sweat stung her peeling shoulders. She hurried toward the main cafe, a full dishwasher's worth of dirty cups and saucers piled on the tables. Customers fanned themselves with laminated picture menus. Elise glanced at her fellow ferry travelers, all feverish and exhausted by the thought of the long voyage ahead, adjusting to cramped conditions after so many days letting their bodies drift. There was nothing so soulless as burnt, white Westerners on the last day of their vacations. Their happiness had betrayed them, and they knew it, taking stock of the few souvenirs they had managed to stow away. Worse, Raina wasn't among them. Elise punched her hips. It was like Raina to make them late. At JFK, they had almost missed their flight to Greece because she'd insisted on having her two suitcases embalmed in plastic wrap. "The bag people," Raina had meant the luggage handlers, "aren't stupid. They know which suitcases to target. They know which ones have jewelry worth stealing." Elise clutched the ring underneath her shirt. Anyone could be a thief. She hiked from cafe to cafe along the port, searching for her friend, growing angrier, pitching the straps of her backpack higher on her shoulders when each cafe lacked the woman she sought. The heat was maniacal in early July. The water 20 feet away offered only a spent, muggy breeze and the accumulation of tourist rubble around the tables. Cheap Velcro-strapped shoes, inert camera equipment, every vest pocket punctuated with too many zippers, the squishy foam ewes of neck pillows, was starting to undermine the peace Elise had brokered in her 10 days on Patmos. A wave of panic took advantage. Did she have her passport, the ferry tickets, her headphones? She groped the front pocket of her bag and found them safely inside, along with a postcard to her sister that she had addressed and stamped, but had neglected to mail. She noticed a yellow Edda mailbox attached to the side of the police station. Before she pushed the postcard into the box, she reread the note she had written, now filled with week-old news and revelations. "Raina and I are hanging out on the very luxe yacht of an extremely sketchy Cypriot scion, falling in lust. R is effing him. Getting tan, and I think I'm finally over Dodie. And in a week, I'll be totally reborn." all damningly false predictions. She wished she were still on that yacht on the afternoon of day 4, in the floating, faraway luxury of soft leather, sanded wood, and Turkish vodka. The captain going under.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.